Welcome to the video. When you're on the path to awakening to the I Am presence of isness, which is our identity, it is identity, everything is grist for your mill. Everything that comes your way goes into your mill, and you grind it down into wheat, and you bake bread, and you eat the bread. So you need everything that takes place in your life that way. It's all grist for your mill. It all goes into your mill, and you mill it down as best you can and bake the best bread that you can bake. And in looking at it that way, you will find breakthroughs that you didn't expect. Whereas if you had reacted to everything as a victim, you won't get those breakthroughs. So you need to look at everything like, ah, great. Here's a great opportunity to really, really, really get something great, no matter what comes your way. Instead of screaming, throwing tantrums, you know. Don't throw a tantrum. Don't throw tantrums. That seems to short-circuit things. When you're throwing a tantrum, you can't be grinding that mill down. You know, grinding it. Today I filled up 4 water barrels, 55-gallon water barrels that I've had. I filled them a long time ago. Just in California, you live in perpetual fear of earthquakes. And after the 89 Loma Prieta earthquake, which felt like a freight train driving through our house, lucky I didn't get killed by bookshelves crashing down and everything. It was horrible. I realized, you know, hey, the earth isn't stable. Okay, it's not stable. I think a lot of people in the world don't quite realize that. A lot do, a lot don't. You live in a fairly stable area, you may think that it's stable. It's not. The earth is not stable. Okay, stuff is moving, stuff is changing, stuff happens. So I got the water barrels, and also there has been continuous outpouring of contact with this planet from extraterrestrial civilizations. That is true. And what they tell us is there is this series of cataclysms coming up. That is their consistent narrative. Now the question is, are they lying or not? What's going on? At any rate, back then I filled my water barrels, and over the years they've got emptied and stuff happened. And they've been sitting there empty for 5, 6, 7 years, just empty. Today I filled them up, which is a good thing. It's a great thing. It's always good. If you live in earthquake country, it's good to have some water stored, okay? Nothing wrong with that. We have these Russian scientists saying the 22nd, sometime around 8 p.m., Pacific Coast time, there's supposed to be some massive cataclysm. Well, it's, what is it, about 7 o'clock Pacific time right now. It's supposed to be, supposed to take place, what, 11 p.m. Eastern Pacific time, something like that. Hasn't happened, nothing's happened. Okay, not unexpected, right? A very curious thing, the ETs have continuously been giving out these messages of cataclysms. And I certainly have received those type of messages and contacts and awarenesses, and was shown the future, everything that's going to happen. So the question is, you know, are they simply, is it just massive lies taking place or what? The history of this planet, if you really dig into it, and I've dug into it my whole life, there are these cataclysms that happen. There's no question about it. Stuff happens here, okay, on this planet. It really does. And so many people around the world are digging into the mechanisms of how does it happen, and we're discovering there are mechanisms for it to happen. The weakening of the magnetic field is part of it. The coronal mass ejections are part of it. The dynamics of the universe are such that stuff happens big time. And so filled the water barrels, that's a good thing. Fixed some lights, did some stuff, you know, got kind of active today, which is a good thing. And hopefully nothing happens. But we, like in California, you know, just one second here.
tape.
We know that there's going to be a big earthquake sometime. We know it, okay? So there will be a cataclysm in California at some point. We just don't know when. And we live, at least I do, in perpetual uneasiness because of that. It's a really a terrible, terrible situation living in California. I guess some people can handle it, some people don't. And I don't like it at all. You know, there's always a feeling like you never know at some point some massive earthquake could happen. And in fact, you know, historically has happened. If you look at the history of California, there have been some amazing things happen periodically here, including great floods. Periodically, great floods, the whole Central Valley gets flooded. They found out there's super floods happen. Massive earthquakes happen periodically, and so we're just a ticking time bomb, which is no fun at all. The world itself is a ticking time bomb. And I think when people set dates, and the dates doesn't happen on the date, people tend to dismiss the whole thing as crazy, which is a shame, because it should be grist for your mill. You should at least realize, you know, we do live on a ticking time bomb. The evidence, the historical record of evidence of this planet, you know, is incontrovertible. There's truly been massive, massive changes, constantly changes taking place. In San Francisco, they dug a massive pit for some huge foundation pillar, 200 feet down, 200 feet down, and they found a woolly mammoth tooth down there, buried 200 feet down. That's a lot of sediment to be deposited in only 15,000 years, if you really think about that. 200 feet of sediment, you know, really? The evidence is amazing on this planet. Most people don't look at it. I have looked at that, and this planet is a wild and woolly place, to say the least. It's a traumatic place. It's a place of massive changes, some of them very rapid changes. Ice dams have broken, bringing about massive floods over continents. You know, ice ages have happened. They're just, it's constantly changing. The only constant in this world is change. And sometimes the change is slow, sometimes it's fast. Sometimes dramatic events take place, sometimes not. So this whole world is a ball of confusion. It is a ball, it's a ball of instability. And we need to, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater just because something doesn't happen in a particular date, you know. Don't say, oh, wow, okay, everything's okay. Someone's an idiot, forget about it, blah, 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 like that. That's, you know, that doesn't get us anywhere. If anything, it needs to heighten our awareness of the situation we're in with this universe. What is this universe, really? Who is this I we think we are, this body-mind? What is that? Is there some way to get free of this, of the fear we have? Is there some way to get free of trauma? All this stuff. These are all questions that can be heightened. We can focus in on them. So I don't mind people setting dates. I don't know. It's kind of an eye-opener, you know. It's like biting into a ghost pepper and like, whoa, you know, wakes you up and say, wow, that's hot. You know, you kind of realize, hey, you know, these things are possible. Just because it didn't happen today doesn't mean it won't happen tomorrow. Not at all. It helps people get ready and focus on what's essential, what's really important. It provides some kind of boost. So I've heard it said some contactee was channeling from, I think, the Grays, and they said, they admitted that they are pathological liars. But they also said that there's a purpose to their lying, that they're doing it on purpose, that it somehow helps accelerate preparation, etc. Whereas let's say something's going to happen in the future for sure. You know, people say, well, December 21st, 2012, something really big is supposed to happen, Mayan calendar, all that stuff. Well, what if everybody just kind of waited for that date to wait and see, and then when they get there, you know, if something happens, they're not prepared. Let's say somebody knew that something is going to happen for sure, let's say that's possible, would they wait and just, would they set that date and just wait for that, or would they, start setting pre-dates? They start saying, you know, on September 22nd, you know, something is going to happen, or back in 2001, something's going to, terrible is going to happen. Set these dates ahead of time, white lies, tell white lies, so that people start focusing and preparing ahead of time, because it's human nature to procrastinate. Okay, we're all subject to that. Very few people will get after it if there's some date in the future. If you just look at human history, you can see that. Always, always, always. You know, it's Jesus is returning, but it's 5 years from now. And then 5 year period, say, oh, it's 5 years. You know, it's always in the future, and we don't quite have to prepare for it right now. Okay, it's not necessary for it right now. It's in the future. We'll do the preparation in the future. But by telling these white lies, apparently the ETs are trying to disturb us enough that we prepare in advance. So actually, even though I've been subjected to these white lies in you know, thinking that things would happen and they have not, actually I didn't get upset about it too much at all, because I said, you know what, I got a lot of benefit out of getting into emergency mode and mode of full effort towards clarification, and it brought out the best, thinking that there's this deadline, you know. Now when the deadline passes, you kind of go, oh wow, nothing happened. And they say, well, that's good. But knowing that in the future that there will be some point where this preparation will be essential. So apparently there are some ETs who tell white lies. They really do. And I think the evidence is so strong for that, that they're setting dates or saying stuff's going to happen and it doesn't happen. People say, well, they're just creating a climate, et cetera, like that. Possible. It also may be they're pre-stressing everyone and getting everyone, you know, into a feeling like there's a deadline. Like, you know, if you thought your final examination was going to happen in 2 weeks, you know, and someone said, no, it's happening tomorrow. What are you going to do? You're going to do an all-nighter, right? Or let's say it's happening in tomorrow night. You're going to stay up all night tonight. You're going to study all day tomorrow, you know. If it's still closed, you're going to put a severe march on, no question about it. Whereas if it's too far in the distance, you won't do anything. You really won't. So there is a dynamic of our behavior that we have, where if it's too far in the future, we just don't do anything. So apparently the ETs keep setting it, the date close enough to us that we feel we really can do something about it, we should do something about it, we do something about it. And here's another example, supposedly. Now I know there's a time frame here of something may happen. I believe it is possible something may happen in a time frame here in late September. It is possible. It wouldn't be a surprise. It wouldn't be a surprise at all. But it also would not be a surprise if this is another white lie, another situation like that, where it's an attention getter. It's an attention getter, preparing us for something that actually will happen a little bit down the road, but that we would kind of just procrastinate about if we didn't get these earlier dates. So that's one way of looking at it. That's one way that I look at it. So it calms out some of the upset that people feel. Now the people in Peru are all upset about the situation right now. But keep in mind that the gist of this whole scenario that's been talked about by the Russian scientists is actually the destruction of the United States. Is that supposedly the Gulf of Mexico is going to flood all the way up and join the Great Lakes. Well, that's not good news for the people in the way of that. And a massive tsunami is supposed to hit the eastern seaboard of the U.S. and wipe that out and destroy all the nuclear reactors we have there and cause, you know, horrible nuclear winter, etc. So, I mean, nothing was said about any destruction in Peru. It was all about the United States, really. So, if anything, the people of the United States should be, you know, concerned or commenting, but they're not. They're not at all. Kind of strange. I don't know if people really listened very carefully to what was being said. We've been down this road before. There's always people who are predicting global cataclysms at some point. It seems that way. And then when they don't happen, they say, well, they were the ETs were able to deflect the cataclysm off, which is hard to determine one way or the other, really, if that is true or not. But that is a standard type of response to situations not happening. So it's a tangled web. I tell you, existence is a very tangled web. And in fact, that's all that it really is. And it will always be that way, unfortunately. And fortunately, we are not bound by existence at all. In fact, we are not a product of existence at all. Existence is a product of us, of what we are. We're the ones producing existence. Existence is not producing us. And that's good news because that means we can stop producing existence. Because existence is actually nothing. We're not producing anything. It's nothing appearing to be something. It's like a mirage, an illusion. It's a hypothetical scenario, a daydream, a fantasy. And we're the ones who are fantasizing it. And literally, nothing has to happen within this fantasy for us to be what we are. We always are what we always are what we are. The isness that we are is always. It always is. It's not a product of existence at all. And yet we see it that way, that somehow what we are is a product of existence. So we fear changes and cataclysms and all this kind of stuff, fearing that's going to somehow destroy our identity, destroy what we are. Now, the theology of these Russian scientists is, way off. It's typical ET stuff about the growth of consciousness. We need to go from what do they call individual consciousness to unity consciousness and all this kind of stuff. It's a very seemingly nice narrative and standard fare. But it has nothing in it that is actually profound at all. And no escape velocity to it whatsoever. So, but again, that's what do you expect? It seems like the ETs, that's all they can do. I've never heard really good non-dual teaching from the ET connections and channelers and all that stuff. Never. They just don't seem. It's all about developing collective consciousness and raising our consciousness and the journey of consciousness as it goes toward perfection. Now, what we are isness already is perfect. It's beyond perfect. It is what is. There is no other. So the whole idea of perfection is just a ridiculous dualistic concept. So when you have this, all the theology, it's typical of these sort of teaching, cataclysmic warnings on dates that the theology is messed up. It's typical of that. Anybody though who tries to predict the future is going to be off by a little bit. You might be in the ballpark. I've had situations where I'm in the ballpark, okay? But it's not cut and dry because the very nature of existence. Existence is very slippery slope, actually. It's not what we think it is. We are fooling ourselves. If we set a date, the nature of existence is such that it's always trying to prove to us that nothing is set in stone. Always trying to do that. And literally, if enough people believe something's going to happen, what will happen? It won't happen. Existence will not let it happen. It'll change to make everybody wrong. And so people say, oh my gosh, nothing is set in stone. Now, why is the belief system of this planet doing that? Well, not this planet, the universe, this whole dream of existence. Why does it do that? Because its basic premise that it's born from is the idea that reality can be changed. And therefore, nothing is set in stone. That is the primary belief of existence, that nothing is set in stone. Everything can be changed. So in order to inculcate this and perpetuate this belief, this false belief, because reality cannot be changed, it constantly keeps us on the wrong side of certainty, as it were. Whenever we think something's going to happen, it doesn't happen. And whenever we think something isn't going to happen, that's when it does happen. It keeps messing with our minds, you know, constantly. Constantly. We almost say that, what do you call that? It's very, very mischievous, and there's another word for it, too. Anyway, people have pointed out that the universe seems to have this quality, it'll come to me, the word, has this quality of deception, is one way to put it, where it sets us up to be disappointed. Sets us up to be disappointed, and then it can point and say, you see, nothing is set in stone. You thought for sure this would happen, and it didn't happen. But I would point out that it's belief itself that's setting up situations that are supposed to happen. Okay. It's not reality. Nothing needs to happen for reality to be what it is. It already is what it is. It's not dependent on something happening or not happening. Belief wants us to believe is that everything is changeable. And therefore, if we believe something for sure is going to happen on a certain date, the universe will change the date on us and won't let it happen then. And we'll think, wow, we can't trust anything. Really can't trust anything. Nothing's set in stone. It undermines our remembrance of reality, our trust in reality. Therefore, keeps the hope alive we can develop a power greater in reality, which is the whole purpose of existence. We can develop a power of negation that we can threaten reality with and force reality to change and make us prime creator. Force the prime creator to change reality and make us prime creator. That's the purpose we're engaged in. In order to keep this purpose going forward, we have to keep believing that it's possible, for one, and two, undermining our belief that there's a home to go back to. And we do that by believing that everything's changeable. Plus, if we didn't believe reality was changeable, we'd never embark upon this effort in the first place. We would just say, forget it. It's impossible. Reality can't be changed. So this whole thing is ridiculous. Let's just choose another idea. So belief, at its premise, believes that reality can be changed. Everything is changeable. That's the fundamental belief of belief. And so it constantly works us this way. There's kind of this arbitrariness in the universe. It's like a trickster, you know? Everyone's noticed that. A very strange trickster. And we always say God works in mysterious ways, you know. The God of existence is a complete failure, complete trickster. Because it's not really a God at all. It's actually simply a belief system. And this belief system does act in very mysterious ways because it has a hidden purpose. And we always say, well, we just have faith in the mystery, the great mystery. There is no mystery, okay? Not for me. I see it as plain as day. The mystery is the purpose of existence. It's what it is, and people just aren't aware of it. If you know what it is, then there is no mystery. You understand why the universe acts the way that it does. It's very clear. It has to continually advance the narrative that nothing's set in stone. Nothing can be relied upon. So it keeps setting us up and then knocking us down, setting us up, knocking us down. So when you have a situation like a September 22nd prophecy, it doesn't happen. It's like we've been set up and then knocked down. Okay, doesn't mean it's not going to happen at some point. It means that the universe has set us up and then knocked us down, and now we're thinking, oh, we can't rely upon anything. Nothing is trustworthy. You know, we get all these feelings like nothing is set in stone. Everything's variable. Everything's changing. Everything's quicksand beneath our feet. And that is a problem for us. It's a complete lie. You know, it's complete deception, total deception. You might call the universe total deception. It's engaged in total deception. So we think the universe is very manipulative, the universe, very manipulative, way more so than we realize. Which is why even the great ascended masters keep getting manipulated by the universe. Those are into consciousness raising and all that kind of stuff, instead of abiding in the presence of the isness, is what we are, which is the true salvation, which we can do right now by realizing nothing needs to happen. So all the past happenings are unimportant. All the future happen important. So right now we can enter into the presence of the isness right now, not needing neither the past or the future. Neither one is necessary. So narrow is the gate. Narrow is the way, meaning right now is the way. Don't need the past or the future. We never do. As long as we think we need the past or the future to be in the presence of isness, we will keep oscillating between the two. You know, we'll keep looking at the past and looking at and then trying to figure out the future, and both the past and the future will be, you know, waving their hands, and we'll get distracted by them. But if we set it down right now, and that narrow way is right here, right now, to experience the I Am presence of isness through the effect of unconditional love, it's possible, always possible right now, never possible in the past, never possible in the future, because it has no need for anything to happen whatsoever. And any belief we have in that some happening needs to take place prevents us from abiding in the presence, because we say we're not ready yet. Something has to happen to make the isness complete, to make it holy. We think, how can we abide in the presence of holiness if something needs to happen first? But when we realize that nothing needs to happen, nothing ever needed to happen, so all our memories and past happenings, the records we have of them, are totally unimportant. And all the future things that could happen are totally unimportant, all of it. Because the isness, the I Am presence of isness, that is our true identity, our one and only identity, it is identity itself, doesn't need anything to happen to be whole, meaning not missing something. It's not missing anything. It doesn't have parts. How could it miss anything? It's not an assemblage of parts. It's complete oneness, wholeness, unity, totally. Nothing needs to happen ever for it to be, or for isness to be what it is, and will always be what it is. It never deteriorates. Nothing needs to happen. We keep it there. So stepping into the I Am presence of isness happening now, when we realize we don't need the past or the future, we don't need them. And then we walk forward through the doorway. There is a doorway, like it's an open door. It's an open door. It's not like you need to open. It's open. But on one side, the door jam. There's a door jam and a wall. There's a wall, and there's like a door in the opening in the wall, like a door. One side you have the past. One side you have the future. And what you do, you just walk right through the door. You say, I don't need the past or the future. Because if we think we need the past, we'll be walking along the wall of the past. If we think we need the future, we'll be walking along the wall of the future, waiting for something to happen, imagining what could happen, instead of going through the door, straight through the door. Straight and narrow is the way. Exactly. It's neither the past nor the future. We don't need either one of them. Nothing needs to happen at all. Never had to happen for isness to be what it is. Isness is not waiting on something to happen. It's not waiting to be completed. We have this vast so-called factory of consciousness in the universe. Isness is not, you know, waiting for this to be completed, thinking that, you know, okay, this is necessary in order for isness to be what it is or something. That is not true at all. That is a fantasy that we have, that we're entertaining. And it seems like most of these ETs are very much ignorant of of this. Which is not to say that they cannot predict certain things to happening in within the dynamics of existence. Two different things, apples and oranges, really. Apples and oranges. Just because someone can predict some event taking place doesn't mean that they know truth. Doesn't mean that they there's some flies flying around here suddenly, or big winged insects. Trying to go to that light bulb. They're attracted to the light bulb. Okay, so just because something can be predicted doesn't mean any, you know, the predictor knows truth. Doesn't mean they don't know either. It's not, there's no correlation between the two. I tell you that. It really isn't. Really isn't. It's not like if there's a false prediction, you know, it doesn't pan out that somehow, you know, we're supposed to go into a rage. Now we can get right back to non-dual teaching, to the straight and narrow way, to go through that doorway to the I Am, presence of isness, experience through unconditional love, love that has no, puts no conditions on being experienced by anyone. We're all free to experience it. Doesn't matter what our past, our future, we think our future may be nothing, no conditions whatsoever. It's unconditional. It's there to be experienced. Right? As I think Sailor Bob Adamson said, what's wrong with right now? There's a certain way of cluing into that, this dynamic is that you don't need anything to happen. And of course, nothing's happening right now. Really. You know, the definition, idea of right now is this, just this, you know, this instant that is somehow not the past or the future. And you can say that, well, nothing of importance is happening now because it hasn't transited the past as an experience yet. All right? It's kind of the instant where it hasn't become a memory yet. The now moment is has not turned into a memory, and it's not turned into a disappointment, where which is projected onto the future and future seeking. It is fresh and free of that past future dynamic. So what is wrong with that? You know, what is wrong with just accepting that and then going through the door? It's not the now moment we're trying to get to. That's a doorway that we walk through. And it's the I Am presence of isness, the isness, abiding in the presence of isness, that is the real goal. I think that some people sit down in the now, the doorway. They sit down in the doorway and they're sitting there in the doorway. Now that's not the point of it. The point is to go through the doorway and to realize that nothing needs to happen. But that realization, nothing needs to happen, is in itself abiding in the presence of the I Am isness. It's not abiding in that presence. It's a way of letting go, as it were. So it's helpful to, you saw that little bug, yeah. It's helpful to focus on that, for sure. But not as a goal in itself. That's why I've never, you know, I appreciate all the efforts of the teachers to talk about stuff like that. But for me, it's always been, you have to go, you know, into the actual experiencing of isness. Do you see the bug there? It showed up just. And it's not really splitting hairs, but it might seem that way. Main thing is, most all of us have to realize that nothing needs to happen. That's the important thing. I think we can leave the field of happenings. Okay? leave the field of time. Because happenings take place in time, don't they? The evidence of that is held, of the happenings is held in the past. And in the future, more happenings will take place. We know that. We leave that behind. We leave the importance of that behind. There's a way to do that. And we have the testimony of many who say that. And we need to get on with that right now. We're in the final third part of 2012. If you divide a year into 4 months, 4 months, 4 months, September, October, November, December is the final third of that year. And certainly there's a saying, where there's smoke, there's fire. And right now there's a lot of smoke. Has been for a lot of time. And there is a feeling like we're in for it, you know, so to speak. Stuff is going to happen, most likely. But again, if we realize that nothing needs to happen for us to be who we are, we're not dependent on any happening, nor non-happening. And we can literally choose to experience the isness, the I am presence of isness that is our identity. We can be experiencing that no matter what is happening in the world. It doesn't matter. If we realize it doesn't matter what's happening, it's not dependent, it's not a product of existence at all. And it's not dependent on anything that's happening in existence, and whatever happens in existence doesn't affect it in any way whatsoever. We can literally experience that unaffected condition, that unaffected experience. We can do that, and we should. We should do that now. We should do it, because if we don't, we're going to get caught up in the happenings, seeing consequences, significance to them, meaning, all of that stuff. Whereas really the whole gist of the entire effort toward 2012 is to go through that narrow way of the now moment into the presence of isness and abide with that isness, realizing it's unaffected by time, any events whatsoever, any happenings whatsoever, has no effect on it. And to abide in that, so no matter what happens in the world, our experiencing is not being affected by that. And the experience is one of you know, bliss, love, seamless peace, wonderful delight. And that's not going to be affected. That is the perfume of reality. So what we're really doing is we're simply allowing ourselves to experience the perfume of reality. And events in time and space don't touch that at all. They do not touch it. That cannot be taken away. There's no tsunami that can take that away from us at all. There's no earthquake that can do anything to that. There's no cataclysms that can affect that in the slightest bit. And if we can find a way and say, I accept the perfume, the experience of the perfume of reality. I accept that experience. And go into that experience, allow it to permeate and abide in that. We can do it. It can be something like that. There are many people throughout the world who are working towards this. Many teachers, many different types who have been working towards this. And it's important to finish the job, to get that final third. You know, and don't just stand in that doorway of now. Go through it. Go through that doorway. And allow that perfume to arise. And be suffused with that perfume of reality. So that others can recognize it and say, hey, yeah, that's exactly what I want too. And how do we get that? Again, and then clarification can take place. And I believe a lot of clarification has taken place over the years. And we're at a point now when we really need those who have done it to come forward. No question about it. No question about that. Time for theory is almost over, really. It's pretty much winding down. And the time for actually going through that door is here. And you could say it is here now. So we don't allow any prediction to knock us off our knock us off track. We're aware that, yes, the possibility is there that stuff is going to happen for sure. And we don't deny it, we don't stick our heads in the sand, but we just say, you know what? That's all the more reason to go through that narrow way. All the more reason to do it now. All the more reason to say, yes, I accept the experience, the perfume of reality. The real perfume. All right, not some floral scent that we manufacture in this world. Don't accept cheap imitations. It doesn't have anything in common. The real fragrance of reality. We accept the fragrance of reality. And just, you know, breathe it in. Allow it to be suffused by it. It may be just as simple as that. My belief is that, well, not belief, but my what I see is that there is a very simple, effective way right within our grasp that we can use. It's simpler than we believe, really. Our belief gets in the way that we really can be suffused by this. Called the divine nectar, the rasa. And that's all we need to do. That's all we really need to do. Because with that, the whole clarity and realization, you know, it comes, the realization, we don't need any realization, arises. And we're not struggling for some realization because we have the divine nectar, the rasa, the fragrance of reality is with us. So what do we need realization for? We already have something way better in realization. So it's almost like it's time to go beyond realization. It's time to go beyond the path, you know, go beyond belief. It really is time to go beyond belief. And for some reason, there's a slight hesitation. And that's something we just have to push past. Gather our nerve. Gather our nerve. And that's what we're doing here. We're gathering our nerve. Even though there was this unnerving prediction, etc., I said, okay, let's look, take a look at this. What's going on here? And then now, okay, we say, okay, come what may, we are gathering our nerve right now to accept the fragrance of reality as our experiencing, be infused and suffused with that simply by accepting that nothing needs to happen here for reality to be what it is. And it's reality is not a product of existence at all. So let the fragrance of that truth suffuse our presence here. And the truth is, we don't need to do any special breathing or techniques or anything. You know, it's a really amazing thing that our belief systems get in the way. We believe we need to do something. So if we were starting to get suffused with this, we would say, oh my gosh, something happened. Now, how did I make it happen? Was I breathing in the right way? Was I my posture right? The food I eat this morning, the thoughts I was having, all this kind of stuff. And then we would get into a side trip about, okay, I need to, you know, breathe in a certain pattern and all this kind of stuff to keep it going. And, you know, it really may be that there's nothing we need to do. It's the realization there's nothing we need to do that opens the path for it. So we won't get caught up in some kind of panic about thinking about how are we doing this. We're not doing it. It's the acceptance that we don't need to do anything. It's not our doing that is bringing this at all. And if we're okay with that, it comes of it. That's the invitation. I believe that, and I have to speak from standpoint of belief at this point. What my conviction is that it comes through invitation. And if the right invitation is made, for sure, it's going to show up. We only have to make the right invitation. That is the trouble. That is really the trouble. And having made many invitations to it in my life, many, my gosh, I could never even count them all, really. But I have to keep tweaking it. You know, so that's not it. That's not it. That's not it. I truly, my conviction is the right invitation, it will come. And the great teachers say that is true. When the student is ready, the master appears, so to speak. When the right invitation is made, the fragrance of reality shows up. And it is something along the lines that we are talking about here, of realizing that the right invitation doesn't matter at all. It makes no difference when we realize that there doesn't need to be a right invitation, and we can accept it. That's when it'll come. It's almost like a paradox, isn't it? When we realize that there's nothing we need to do to make it arrive, that's when it arrives. That's the invitation. Nothing needs to happen, including the right invitation. As long as we're attached to right action, it won't come. It won't arrive. Because we think that there's something we're doing that somehow is bringing it in. Whereas if we realize there isn't any conditions, it's unconditional. Reality is unconditional. Unconditional love, unconditional. There are no conditions. So when we are willing to accept that, then it comes for us. It arrives on our doorstep, so to speak. So many of us think we're not making progress, when in fact we are. Because you think, wow, nothing works. That's progress. That's great progress. You only need to go to the point then and say, well, nothing needs to work. Doesn't matter. And accept it. It's unconditional. There aren't any conditions for it. Everybody can have it right now. This moment, it's offered to everyone. It's ready to suffuse everyone. But everyone is still caught up in what do I need to do to get it? It's only when you realize you don't need to do anything to get it. That's when it comes. Says, the door is open now. I can come on in. You know, the window's has been opened. The breeze can come in. I don't need any technique. I don't need any goodness or badness. I don't need anything. It's simply arriving because it is. And I'm willing to accept what is. No conditions. There are no conditions. Reality holds no conditions. It simply is. So we're trying to impose conditions. Like you're saying, it isn't only is when I do these mantras and breathing exercises. Won't show up then. Because that'll just reinforce insanity, delusion. But when we can say, you know what, I don't need to do anything. Doesn't matter what I'm doing or not doing. Then there's the real invitation. So we are all trying to extend the right invitation. Get to the point where we realize that there isn't a right invitation. Doesn't matter. No invitation is needed. When we get to that point, then it should arrive at that point. When we really can internalize that and accept it. There isn't any technique. Never has been. Isness is not waiting on us to develop some technique. It's waiting for us to accept that there is no technique needed. No realization needed. No invitation needed. And that's kind of a mind blower for us, you know. Nothing needs to happen. But when we can let that happen and realize, you know, it's here and it's not because of anything we did or anyone else did at all. It's simply from us accepting, you know. Let's choose a new idea. Let's stop trying to deny isness and hide this denial behind all this talk of like somehow we need to realize something. We're working on some spiritual path. We have to do all this stuff first. There's nothing we need to do. Nothing that anyone needs to do. It's not just us. Nothing that anyone needs to do. Nothing at all needs to be done. And when we have, when we can accept that, it will dawn upon us. The fragrance of reality will dawn upon us. When we can accept to a certain extent, internalize that, it will dawn upon us. That is a very strong conviction that I have. It's almost like I feel a certainty. And there's nothing we need to do it. If there's nothing we need to do for it to arrive, also there's nothing we need to do to sustain it. So we don't need to be front running, say, wait, I better write a book real fast, you know, because I got to get this down on how it feels and all this kind of stuff, because if I don't do it, it won't be sustained and all this stuff. No. The great gurus often, they never did anything, no writing. They just, you know, they're showing us, there's no, you don't need to do anything to sustain it. Reality is self-sustained. It's not in danger of not being sustained. It doesn't need anything to happen to be sustained. It doesn't need some outside agency to sustain it. It doesn't need to do anything to sustain itself. It's not dependent on something to sustain it. So we don't need to do anything to arrive. We don't need to do anything to sustain it. That's so, you know, this is a great day. This is an example of using experiences as grist for the mill, and you don't allow yourself to be pulled down by anything that happens in the world, because none of it really matters at all from the standpoint of experiencing the fragrance of isness, of reality. We need to realize that again. Don't need to do anything. Don't need to not do anything. Nothing has to happen one way or the other. Doesn't matter at all. And therefore, it can arrive. It can arrive for us. It will arrive. When it's not going to entangle us into some kind of effort to make things worse. So we wonder, how come it doesn't arrive, you know, and just sweep away all our, you know, sweep away all our resistances? Because as long as we're attached to belief and still our desire to be prime creator, when it arrives, if it arrived, we would feel we're being attacked. We'd do all sorts of stuff. We'd think, oh my gosh, we need to sustain it. We need to remember what we did to make it arrive. We need to make religion out of what we did to make it arrive. We need all these exercises. I got to be a teacher. But oh God, it goes on and on and on. It's just terrible. If you look at the real teachers like a Ramana or Ananda Maima, they're just abiding in it. And they're showing us we don't need to do anything to sustain it. We didn't do anything to make it come. We don't need to do anything. That's it. It's completely simple. Ramana said, just abide in the self. That's all you need to do. That's it. Just accept this abidance. They're not trying to, you know, churn out, you know, some special text, you know, of how to get there and how to sustain it and all this kind of stuff. Just the opposite. They're turning us in the right direction. No effort. Really. Don't need to do anything. No circumstances required. No invitation, no realization, no technique, all of that. And we've heard this, but it's possible to internalize it and put it in the right context so that when this fragrance arrives for us, simply let it arrive. It is there. Don't need to do anything about it. Just abide in it. And so we can do that. It will happen when we get this internalization and just say, okay, we're good with that. It's not a product of belief. It's not a product of existence. It's not a product of a hypothetical. You know, that's the problem. We think, oh, the hypothetical has suddenly become real. How did that happen? And then we start thinking like, wow, we figured out a way to do it. You know, I got to tell everybody there's a way to make the hypothetical real. And then we go off on side trips, you know. No, it's not the hypothetical becoming real. It's a real, it's no, it's accepting the fact the hypothetical can never be real. And so nothing has to happen. It's not a happening. This arrival of this fragrance reality is not a happening. It's not something that happened to something. Some happening didn't bring it about. It's acceptance that it doesn't need a happening to arrive, to be what it is, that enables this arrival to take place. The arising of it to take place. And so we're in a perfect time now to focus in on this and get real about it. Stop playing around. To actually listen and take this in and say, okay, good. Take it in and hear it, and say, feel it and say, ah, okay, yes, all right, yeah. There doesn't even need to be any comprehension of what takes place. The fragrance is the fragrance. Why does there need to be comprehension? Just experience it, not comprehend it. There's no need for comprehension. It's there. It is. What needs to be comprehended? How it arose? No, it's always been there. It's only when we realize that it doesn't need our comprehension to be what it is, then we're willing to say, okay, let's experience it as it is, instead of through some comprehension, through some concept. I don't need to comprehend it. It is. It's perfect. It's flawless. What need is there for comprehension to fit it into some context or something? No, that's not needed. It's not needed. No comprehension required. Because if it's perfect, why do we attention to what? To complete it? To make it holy? It's already holy. So it's not required. Comprehension not required. And my hope is that everyone around the world is getting into this. Okay? I wish there were a lot more getting into it. Because it is super important right now to get into it. Get into this current. No comprehension really required. Nothing needs to happen. Get into that current. Otherwise, the alternative is pretty not so good, pretty bleak. A lot of fear. A lot of attempts to comprehend. Okay? We don't want to comprehend. We want to experience the fragrance of reality that doesn't need comprehension. We want that experience of that which doesn't need, require comprehension. Otherwise, we're truly going to get dragged through the mud of desperate attempts to comprehend what the heck is going on in this world, because there is a vast amount of accelerated change taking place in the energy universe of existence, which is only a hypothetical scenario, really, that we're imagining. Massive, massive accelerated change. That is true. Now, exactly what will happen and when? Okay, we don't, whatever happens, happens. But again, we're realizing nothing needs to happen for us to experience the fragrance of reality, and we don't need to comprehend anything. Okay, so it's you either go one way or the other, really, one way or the other. Right now, the middle ground. What is the middle ground? What is the middle ground right now? Has there ever really been a middle ground? Not really. There seems to have been, but it is not. You either are going towards greater and greater comprehension, attempts to comprehend and work and make things happen the way you want to happen, or you're going to accept the fragrance of reality and realize no comprehension, nothing needs to happen. You either go one way or the other. You can't go both ways simultaneously. Cannot. So the middle ground would be what? Going both ways simultaneously? That's not possible. Or merely oscillating, Oscillation is really not very possible either, because each way will really attract you, and powerfully in that way. You're not just going to just oscillate back and forth like, I have really no interest in either, that kind of thing. That's not possible. So really feel the urgency of the times and respond to the urgency of the times. Which is what we're doing here. And it's great to put forth these efforts toward clarification. Clarification has a place, has a very strong place. And ultimately it leads to this, again, realization that nothing, no realization is required. An acceptance of it. And actual abiding in the fragrance of reality, rather than any attempt to clarify, any more clarification. No more clarification required. That's the ultimate goal. And it's a goal that is absolutely reachable. It's something that will take place when the door is opened, as it were. It will take place, for sure. Okay, very great. That's it for this video.